please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Ashwani Gujral, Sudarshan Sukhani and Mitesh Thakkar now join us on a day where we could hit 11,000. Okay, the SGX Nifty is now indicating that maybe, it happens with the gap up. Of course, now the futures are at par with spot because you are in expiry week. Good morning, everyone. Ashwani, your thoughts on the way the market has moved up and the way some of the large stocks moved yesterday, like TCS. How would you trade the index?
Good morning, Anuj. I think often at round numbers, people tend to sell a bit for some reason. They'll sell some at 10,000, 9,000, 11,000. So maybe, today we hit 11,000 early morning, and then from there, a bit of cool off, etc., can happen. But I think more than the banks, the bigger bull market is now starting in IT. IT index is going to cross 12,900, 950, which was a previous high. And that opens up, levels right up to 17,000. So given that, you don't expect large dips because either IT or banks and other stocks will participate. But the idea should be to try to wait for dips, because now the 20-day moving average on Bank Nifty is 25,800 and on Nifty is 10,650. So as you go further and further away, the likelihood of snapbacks increase. So if you are buying today in the morning, you have to be extremely cautious. If you are carrying positions from previously, I think you can still continue to carry.
Okay, Sudarshan Sukhani and Mitesh Thakkar are also with us. Let's find out what their view is. Sudarshan, would you concur with that view that if you have positions already on the long side, continue to carry them? And what should the fresh call be on the index once it hits 11,000?
Yeah, good morning, Sonia. See, we have been asking traders to go on buying the Nifty at every dip and on every breakout. And traders should be carrying the Nifty, and they have to carry this index continuously till the market proves otherwise. We are not going to call a top in the market because we are not competent to do so. So carry all long positions, even on days like this when the markets are crossing a round figure, buy on a dip. You still have to define that dip, but broadly it would be a 20 to 30 point decline from wherever the market opens. And do intraday trades, add to your positions till the market reverses. We remain bullish. We have been bullish for a long time now, and the market is not giving us a chance to do otherwise. We remain on the long side, and don't make the mistake of going short.
Okay, no, that point is taken, Sudarshan. I can understand for the intraday trade, you buy on a dip. But what if the market doesn't give you a dip, especially if you're a positional trader?
Yes, but then you have to keep on holding the Nifty you have. That's a very fair question. If you don't get a 30-point dip, I don't think you can buy a breakout, because that breakout will carry more risk. Then you keep on holding your long positions and just stay with them. Okay. Put a stop of 10,900.
Fair enough. Mitesh, your Nifty Bank, Nifty strategy?
Good morning, Lata. I think, we've been slightly cautious on the index, suggesting that the intraday charts are overbought, but the momentum hasn't slowed down. Clearly, trading stocks is what we've been resorting to, and while we've had a target of around 11,000 on the Nifty, difficult to come out with fresh targets immediately. I think beyond that 11,250 is some kind of an extension target, so maybe that will happen. But I do expect around 11,000 some profit booking to happen, so maybe 1 or 2 days you might see that profit booking dip come in, which will give you fresh buying opportunity on the indices. On the downside, 10,900, 10,880 is my immediate support pivot. So anything close to those levels, this is where I would consider buying the Nifty.
Okay, let's discuss stocks. Ashwani, before we go through your list, I just wanted your thoughts on Axis Bank, where, of course, you made this call yesterday that you're buying the stock ahead of numbers, saying that the worst is over. What would be the call on the stock now, post the numbers and your other stock calls?
See, the way I look at stocks is, why do stocks go up? Not because of news. They go up because bears cover their positions and bulls take positions. We saw at 5:30 large investors taking positions. So those were the first bulls. I think with yesterday's news, I think the bears who are still there would tend to get scared and the market would latch on to the positives. So I wouldn't be surprised if it moves up to, you know, 640, 650, which is all-time high on Axis Bank. So chances are this time it crosses that zone, maybe next quarter's results, etc. But today I feel that 640, 650 is a distinct possibility. As far as other stocks are concerned, mid-cap real estate is doing very well. Godrej Property is still a buy with a stop of 860, target of 940. Vakrangi Software is a buy with a stop of 468, target of 490. Sonata Software is a buy with a stop of 307, target of 324. Yes Bank is a buy with a stop of 350, target of 375. And BHEL is a buy with a stop of 104, target of 114.
Oh, yes. BHEL has come out and performed after a bit, hasn't it? Sudarshan, are you two going with all buys at all?
Well, mostly buys. And okay, really, we have a short sell only just to balance it out. Don't go short in this market.
Okay.
Bharat Forge is a buying opportunity. The stock has been an outperformer. It's in a trading range. And this range is likely to break on the upside. And we just heard Ashwini talk about IT, and rightly. And Infosys is a buy today. And IT is coming in all our lists. Every day, some stock or the other on the large caps. Infosys is a buying opportunity. A four-day trading range could again break on the upside, which is why I'm saying that we do not have to call a top in the market. A lot of stocks are saying we are willing to go higher. M&M Finance has been an outperformer in the NBFC space. While NBFCs were falling, M&M Finance was steadily going up. It's been just locked in a consolidation for 2 weeks. Another breakout expected on the upside. And finally, I have Marico on the long side, where we are buying on a dip. Marico has done nothing. So this is in anticipation that it will play catch up. And there is a short sell, that is Dalmia Bharat. Surprisingly, the stock, which is in F&O now, has made a bearish head and shoulder. That's in this market. It's a day trade on the short side.
Okay, Sudarshan, before I move to Mitesh, I wanted to ask you your views on Asian Paints, because although the numbers are weak, there is an expectation that the stock could be down today. Asian Paints is generally the proxy to, you know, the Indian economy, and it always, almost always sees buying on every dip. For long-term investors, would you suggest that, picking the stock if it falls today?
I think even at current levels, it's a buying opportunity. If it falls today, somebody who's willing to buy should buy it. It will remain an outperformer. The period of consolidation will get over. So it's a good time to go long.
Mm. Okay. And Mitesh, what about you? What would be on your buy and sell list this morning?
Yeah. So I have mostly buy calls with one sell call. BHFL is a buy. I think the candlestick pattern is quite positive. Keep a stop at 622. Look for targets of 650. Oracle Finance is a buy. Keep a stop at 4150. Look for targets of around 4340. Reliance is an obvious buy. I think after a long, long time, it's managed to get past and close above those levels of 955. So now keep a stop at 950. Look for targets of 1020 on the upside. And BHEL is my final buy call. The intraday charts have again signaled an upside. So that's a buy with a stop at 100. Look for targets of 112. One sell call. That's on MGL. And the gas stocks are correcting a bit. So MGL is a sell with a stop at 1060 for targets of around 1010.
Well, I just want to point out that DHFL, of course, is in F&O band. So if you are taking this call, that's either intraday or if your broker allows, or in cash market.
Okay,
that
well,
call.
Can I just ask one quick question to everybody? I know all three of you have warned us of resistance at 11,000, and Sudarshan as well, that a gap up should not be bought. But nevertheless, all three of you, what are the chances of 11,000 today, Sudarshan?
Oh, I think it's a given. There's no doubt we'll get 11,000 today.
Okay, Mitesh?
Yeah, I think, you know, a strong chance. I would say 9 on 10 times or 90% probability of us getting at least, you know, at least getting past the 11,000 mark sometime during the day.
During the day. And Ashwini?
Well, what I would be interested in seeing how much further we go from 11,000, because that is what will get people in. And that is what you have to be cautious against, that if you get in at 11,050 and the market drops to 10,950, then what happens? Generally, that's how these sort of days kind of play out.
Okay, well, we'll come back to you guys in a bit. But for now, Axis Bank, which came out with its third quarter numbers yesterday, managed to beat street expectations on most parameters. But in the conference call, there were some concerns on issues like the non-watch list slippages, etc. Rakesh Tarve of Reliance Securities joins us on the line with his take on the numbers. Rakesh, hi, good morning. Asset quality has improved, but, you know, the non-watch list slippages once again is a bit of a concern. What would your call be on the stock as well as the on the conference call takeaways?
I would like to believe that, would like to focus on the total slippages. That total slippages number has actually considerably come down. Mm-hmm. They have guided for a lower credit cost in 1 year ahead. All this, plus they have raised money. So all this will augur well for a good credit growth. Plus the system credit growth is picking up now after a long time on the corporate side. So all these things augur well for Axis Bank. Mm-hmm. We have upgraded our rating from hold to buy, and on the target price for the we'll revise our target price on that.
Okay. Well, you know, there was a bit of squabbling or complaining by some analysts that the non-watch list slippages have increased. Also, the list or the kitty under the BB and lower rating, that amount has gone up. Are these worries at all?
As I said, we would like to look at the total slippages, because watch list and non-watch list is a categorization. If total slippages are coming down, they are under control. It simply means that asset quality is going to do well. Non-watch list slippages being more, it just means that, okay, something was not classified under watch list. It has also come out. But if your total slippages are controlled, it means that your asset quality is getting better.
I take your point. I mean, yeah, I mean, just to we are asking you only just to reiterate that point, that in any case the percentage of the good book is still higher than it was in the previous times. Okay, now what's the price target?
Now what's the
price target? Sorry,
price target we are working on. We have upgraded our target from rating from hold to buy.
Okay, from a hold to a buy. Thanks a lot, Rakesh, for joining us. So that's the word coming in. A lot of upgrades, actually, on Axis Bank post their numbers. The stock was one of the big gainers yesterday.
Well, a sign of growth, of course, is when capital goods companies get more orders. And Kalpataru Power has bagged a host of new orders. We understand that the total amounts to 870 crore. Manish Munnoth, the managing director of Kalpataru Power Transmission, is joining us on the phone line. Can you give us more details about this, Manish? Who gave you these orders? For what tenure is it? And what margins do they fetch?
Good morning, Lata. So we've got a few orders, some of it from domestic transmission. So domestic transmission, we've got orders of around 400 crores from SCBs and from neighboring countries. We've also got one big order on pipeline augmentation from a private sector company of around 366 crores and orders in railway electrification of around 120 plus crores. All these orders need to be executed in the next 18 to 24 months, and they would be at a standard margin of anywhere between 8 to 12%.
So okay. What does this do overall to your order book, and what is the expectation as far as revenue growth is concerned as well?
So for the current year, we've got orders of around 6,800 crores against our targeted of 8,000 crores for the year. Our order book should be in the range of 11,000 crores at the end of quarter three. On an overall revenue basis, we had guided for a growth of 15% for the annualized revenue growth, and we are confident of achieving that kind of growth.
But Manish, at the end of September 30th, you told us that your order book is 9,620. Now you're saying 6,800. It looks like you're executing faster than you are getting new orders.
No, so 6,800 was the order book for the entire 10 months as of today. Right. So as of September, some orders had already come in. So and quarter three and quarter and currently we've got some more orders. So 6,800 is for 10 months starting from April till now. So on a total overall basis, we believe that our order book should be around 11,000 crores by the quarter end December.
Okay.
And in the export business, have you seen the T&D orders pick up there as well? And if yes, what kind of geographies are you looking at?
So we've seen a lot of traction on the export business, also primarily coming from the African continent, African and CIS continent. We continue to be L1 in a lot of orders, and at a Kalpatru level, we are L1 in orders exceeding 3,000 crores, out of which more than 50% would be out of export business. So we see a lot of traction, and we expect all these orders to come in the next few months.
All right. What margins did you say? I think you were running at 10.9% when you last announced numbers.
So we've guided the street for margins in the range of 10.5% to 11%, and I think we're confident that we should be able to achieve our guidance.
Are you getting a sense at all that the order flow has improved compared to 2017?
Yes, in the previous year, our order inflow was only in the range of 6,500 crores. And okay. In the current year, in 10 months, we've reached 6,800 and we still have 2 months to go.
Fair enough.
So definitely there's improvement in that.
Sure, okay. We'll leave it at that.
Thanks a lot, Manish, for joining us. That's the word coming in from Kalpatru Power. In fact, Prakash Diwan, a market expert, also joins into this discussion. Prakash, hi, good morning. Kalpatru is a stock that has gone up, what, 40-50% over the last 6 months. Is this something that you would recommend to investors to even buy into at these levels?
I think certainly, Sonia, this has been a steady compounder distinctly, and I don't see any reason why it would get off track in terms of, you know, good order flow, good execution. And, you know, interestingly, what's happening is this industry is something that the government also realizes would need to be, you know, amply supported in terms of releasing payments. So the realization is something that has improved over the last two quarters, as we've seen. So, you know, thanks to the kind of budgets that have been assigned to this entire power sector. And interestingly, they have a very balanced portfolio. They do get a lot of business from the SAARC nations and stuff like that, which also kind of helps. So I think it's definitely a good place to be in. And there's no reason why people shouldn't be nibbling into it. Of course, valuation aside, you know, you need to do your own homework, whether you're comfortable with the levels and things like that. But definitely a good stock to have.
Prakash, where are you? White backdrop, high neck shirt. Are you in Davos by any chance?
Davos seems to be anyways overcrowded, I guess, this time around.
You prefer Shimla instead, is it?
Yeah, I'll prefer to listen to Shireen and CNBC TV18 to get me Davos at home.
Oh, yes,
actually, Dalhousie has a place where they call it Little Switzerland.
You know? Yeah, that's what. Yeah,
is that where you are? Okay.
You know, Mumbai has a place where they call Chota Kashmir. And that's nothing, you know.
Close to Kashmir.
It's not in the worst place. Anyway, but Prakash, good morning. Couple of stocks that I want to discuss with you: Havells and also Just Dial.
Yeah, so, you know, Havells is the interesting one. I think if you were to look at modernization of housing, and, you know, while we talk a lot about affordable housing, Anuj, there's definitely a huge theme that's playing out. And you know, if you look at the quiet performance delivered by some of these simple players within that value chain, you look at Bajaj Electricals. There's no reason why, you know, Havells with now such a big, strong portfolio would start delivering much more. So I'm extremely positive on Havells. In fact, we have a very strong recommendation since the last 6 months, ever since, you know, the corporate action and the new business acquisition happened. So that's definitely Just Dial. I think, you know, I was looking at the numbers and they did confound me as well, and which for the simple reason that this was a business that was lying low, sleepy of sorts. People had written it off. Suddenly, I think it's the 4G availability, thanks to the Jio onslaught, that you know, things like Just Dial have started kind of finding a second life of sorts. And I think this would continue because the segment of new users are not, you know, very Google oriented or you know, they don't have this traditional early adaptation of the search engines. And Just Dial does provide a very localized, easy to use kind of a vernacular driven format. So my sense is that you probably see this company making the right kind of, you know, moves, utilizing this architecture of the 4G availability, and their apps would start kind of getting simpler for these kind of users. So quite positive on it, but I would want to look back into some more details before, you know, getting a buy call. But definitely there seems to be some fundamental changes afoot.
Okay, Prakash, how would you react to this news report that JLR will temporarily reduce production at its Halewood plant in UK?
Yeah, so, you know, I think this is, Lata, this has been kind of on the cards for a while. We did hear the management allude to this obliquely, so not so directly. This probably statement from Reuters is more direct. And until April, things probably don't look so bad because they, what they're talking about is cutting down on sales. Now, remember, JLR sells one out of three vehicles in the UK. And that's quite a huge market share by global standards. So what they're trying to do is manage inventory and not kind of, you know, have try and cut down on the variable costs wherever they can. But, you know, the overall growth that JLR gets the benefit of from China, from parts of other parts of Europe, I wouldn't read too much into the Brexit thing at this point in time, except for the, you know, new emission norms and the taxation that will become slightly heavier for fossil fuel driven vehicles. But then, you know, JLR definitely would have to come with a strategy on electric vehicles at some stage to counter this. And then that's going to be more of a global thing. So till then, there could be a little bit of softness, but I wouldn't be worried. And if the question is on Tata Motors specifically, whether that takes a hit, I think I would buy into it given this softness, because this would get countered by a lot of other benefits that Tata Motors is seeing and the uptick that it's seeing on the CV cycle within India. So the softness in JLR globally has a diluted impact on Tata Motors, JLR in India, and, you know, the other things counter it. So it's a buy for me if there's a dip in Tata Motors.